our next speaker, Dr. Fairman. Dr. Fairman is an assistant professor of exercise science and director of the Exercise Oncology Lab at the University of South Carolina. His primary research focus is examining the impact of exercise, nutrition, and supplementation interventions during and after cancer treatments. The purpose of this research is to see if we can prevent or reduce the side effects experienced with cancer and its treatments. Specific research areas include the investigation of resistance training across the cancer continuum, nutrition and supplementation to augment training adaptations, exercise medicine, and tumor biology. We want to thank Dr. Fairman for joining us. Dr. Fairman, the mic is yours.
Beautiful. Let's do that. How are we looking? We're good?
You look perfect, yeah.
Beautiful. Well, first off, a huge thank you to Matt and all the crew at UCF. I've been a part of, as we all have, a lot of online conferences, and I can say that the effort that's gone into this has been so impressive, and what you lot have been able to pull off has been amazing. So it's an honor for me to be here alongside a lot of really cool speakers. And in the spirit of home-based presentations, I'd like to introduce Lupe, who is my co-presenter. He is a teacup Yorkie, 7 years old, and will also be available for questioning at the end of the presentation. So as we mentioned, my main focus is looking at resistance training and cancer care. And what I hope to do today, understanding the audience, is more give you kind of the 40-foot overview of what we're trying to do, what the rationale is for it, and what we've kind of done so far, and where I think are some really unique and interesting areas are moving forward. And before we get into it, I do want to disclose that I serve as a member on a medical advisory board for a couple of exercise oncology companies. And also, as far as conflict of interest and bias, I do believe that exercise can be beneficial for individuals with cancer. So I certainly have to keep that in mind when I'm designing my trials and interpreting results. But the focus of today really is kind of in line with three separate or kind of related issues, I suppose, in cancer. One is muscle, which I'll spend the majority of our time on, chat a little bit about bone, and then we'll also speak about symptomology and how we can look at resistance training in that manner too. So if we dig into muscle, a lot of us may have heard of different types of cancer treatment, and this slide is a semester-long lecture in itself when we talk about the different types of cancer treatments and how they impact the body systems. Individuals who are diagnosed with cancer, depending on the stage and depending on the type, can get, I say as little with parentheses, like as little as surgery, all the way up to getting surgery, chemotherapy, radiation, and hormonal therapy. So it can be really intense in terms of the burden of the treatment, particularly on physical and mental well-being. And this list of side effects is certainly not exhaustive. But as you're looking through as an exercise physiologist or with our exercise background, you're kind of looking at a few of those things and going, do you know what? Some of the side effects of exercise the side effects of cancer mirror the positive effects of exercise. And so that's kind of really where the field of exercise oncology was born from, in trying to see how we could mitigate some of these side effects. What I'll focus today on is primarily looking at muscle loss, strength of function, and bone fragility in particular. But I'll start with the quiz question. So it should pop up somewhere. So if we think about how these treatments impact individuals with cancer, at what rate do individuals with cancer lose muscle compared to individuals without cancer or who aren't getting chemo or radiation or any of those treatments?
All the answers are coming in. We'll give them a few seconds here to respond.
Beautiful. So that is kind of the answer I was anticipating. I would really say all of the above. What I'm going to do is profile what I think or what is going to demonstrate to you an accelerated loss of muscle with cancer treatments. But I want to prime you to that in understanding that there is quite a bit of variability depending on the type of cancer, the type of treatment, when you are diagnosed in your life. But in general, we do see this accelerated aging. So if we go back, where is our, there we go. So if you're in this field, you will have seen some sort of graph similar to this. So if we plot age across time and we plot musculoskeletal fitness against that there, we generally see that musculoskeletal fitness, mass and function peaks in around, 30. For me, it peaked about 25. I've been on a decline for a few years. But gradually, over the decades, we start to lose mass and function without intervention, and we eventually progress towards this kind of frail and disability condition where we have a reduced ability to perform ADLs and ultimately a progression towards assisted living and mortality and things like that. If you arbitrarily assume that a lot of folks with cancer will get a diagnosis in around middle to later life, what we see is this accelerated decline in musculoskeletal fitness that begins at the onset of treatment, progresses quite rapidly across treatment, and it actually it's difficult to recover that. So what I'm going to do is dig into some of the mechanisms of this, because there's been a lot of really cool work in this area. If we think about muscle loss, whether it's in cancer or outside of cancer, it's an imbalance between anabolic and catabolic factors. So in the context of cancer, a fairly intuitive one can be a lack of activity, particularly lack of resistance training. This can reduce overall energy expenditure. It can be compounded by increases in fatigue as a result of the cancer or its treatments. But certainly it causes or facilitates this imbalance in anabolic and catabolic factors. And if you're not doing anything to preserve muscle, it accelerates that loss. We also have altered adipose tissue metabolism, whether it's a consequence again of the treatment or the tumor. We've got some insulin resistance that exists, and certainly some fatty acid infiltration into the muscle. So we have a reduced quality of muscle tissue as well. Nutrient intake and absorption is a massive factor for a lot of folks going through different types of treatments, whether it's a result of the location of the tumor or the specific types of treatment. You inherently think of things like pain and fatigue and nausea and taste changes with treatment that make it difficult to consume sufficient energy and the appropriate nutrients that would warrant maintaining muscle mass. But really importantly, this is all facilitated by the tumor, where if you imagine, say, head and neck cancer, for example, head and neck cancer is anything literally neck up aside from the brain. And so if you have a tumor in part of your jaw, well, you're not going to be able to consume enough calories. If you've got a tumor in around your neck area, you're not going to be able to chew or to eat or to get the calories and nutrients into you. So a lot of folks are end up taking feeding tubes or deal with enteral nutrition just to try and get sufficient calories into their body. This can also be really impacted by the treatment itself. So again, if we go back to head and neck cancer, if you've had a tumor in your neck or in your jaw and you've got surgery to remove that, or you remove part of your tongue, well, eating and swallowing is going to be a really big concern. And on top of that, if you were to have radiation to your esophagus, well, the pain that comes with that and the loss of saliva and all the other things that come with the side effects of that, it's going to be really difficult to consume adequate nutrients, to talk about maintaining or increasing muscle mass. So this is certainly a contributing factor. In addition to, the tumor can actually have independent effects on signaling pathways within the muscle itself, in addition to treatment. So, we generally think about fatigue with treatment. The cancer-related fatigue is, it's a more extreme version of what we think is general fatigue. It's not alleviated by rest. There's a lot of psychosocial factors that go in on top of it. So the perspective of stepping back from this is, when we say, look, you should do some resistance training and exercise, and someone's just been diagnosed with cancer, it has to be put in the context of, they're not just dealing with the treatments themselves. They're dealing with the financial burden of that. They're dealing with the emotional burden of that. They're dealing with, how do I tell my friends or my family, or how am I going to manage work, or how am I going to get back and forth from the hospital to get to my treatments, and all these other psychosocial factors and logistical challenges that are really heavy for someone to deal with. And so all of these things can contribute to to fatigue, and in particular, the relation between chemotherapy and muscle signal is probably the strongest link, with specific impact on various anabolic and catabolic pathways that dramatically accelerate muscle loss with different chemo agents. And so when you look at this and we say, well, you know, muscle loss is a big factor, why don't they just eat more, which is a lot of what we call conventional nutritional support. If someone literally can't eat, they're not going to be able to consume enough protein intake or whatever it is to actually maintain muscle mass. If they've got a bunch of comorbidities and different impairments that limit their ability to participate in exercise, it's another barrier to maintain in mass. So all of these factors together demonstrate how messy it is and how variable the incidence and the prevalence and the rate of loss in cancer. But in general, the understanding is this: all of these factors are kind of mediated by this high-grade inflammation that is a consequence of the tumor and the treatments. And so a lot of efforts have been developed to try and target inflammation to mediate some of the responses and make the burden or the barriers to anabolism, I suppose, a little bit lower. This slide, to kind of give you an idea of like the magnitude of what we're talking about, this slide was inspired by Jessica Scott, who's at MSK up in New York. They do some fantastic work in exercise oncology. If we were to take this review by Jiang et al. Last year, reviewed all of the work that's looked at loss of muscle loss with chemotherapy. And I'll say that this graph here, 52 months, that 52 months is kind of an outlier in the context of this review. The majority of work in this review was anywhere from 2 to 30-ish months of treatment. So put that into context, about 6% loss of muscle in anywhere from 2 to 36 months with treatment, with chemotherapy. Then you look at androgen deprivation therapy, which I haven't spoken about. So ADT, as it's called, is a treatment for prostate cancer. So testosterone is a key driver of prostate cancer growth. So a lot of the treatment will be, let's remove the testosterone from the body. So they castrate men using ADT. So inherently, you think there's going to be a lot of body composition changes. So again, another fantastic review by Owen et al. A few years ago looked at anywhere from 3 to 12 months of ADT, you're looking at in and around a 5% loss of lean mass. So these losses in themselves are quite alarming, particularly when you think in the context of a lot of folks will be middle to older age, going to have a lot of difficulty recovering this. If you pull up any review under the sun in terms of natural age and what happens as we age, you're looking at that similar rate of decline that would occur in months with treatment occurs in decades with natural aging. So we literally have this phenomenon where there's an accelerated aging at rates of loss in months with cancer treatment that you would experience in decades of aging. So it's certainly something that we're really trying to develop strategies to prevent it and target it as much as we can. So that kind of reviews that concept there, where we do have this loss. And even once the burden of treatment is lifted in cancers that are treatments that have been delivered with curative intent, so not metastatic or not kind of palliative stage, once the burden of treatment is lifted, you might see some spontaneous recovery, but certainly without intervention, we have this prolonged disability. And we do start to see this accelerated decline with cancer. And this kind of delta is what we call cancer-related dysfunction. So all of our strategies in the world of exercise ecology, particularly from a muscle perspective, is trying to do whatever we can to bridge this gap and to extend the quality and quantity of folks' lives as much as we can after or during and after treatment, I suppose. Because there's a lot of consequences of this. So inherently, as you're thinking about this, losing mass, we've got a lot loss of muscle mass and function. Certainly a risk of fractures, particularly when you consider losses of bone mineral density with a lot of treatments as well. Psychosocial impact of it in terms of self-efficacy, the fears of falling and things like that. A really interesting growing body of literature is starting to make the connection between low muscle mass and increased treatment toxicities. So a lot of the chemotherapies in particular are metabolized by muscle. So if you've got low muscle, you've kind of got less surface area to metabolize the drug and a greater amount of toxicities that persist with it. So this this evidence is growing. It's a bit messy trying to get these data, but it's certainly starting to allude to this idea that if you have low muscle mass at diagnosis or start to lose it with treatment, you've got greater treatment-related toxicities, which could potentially impact the efficacy of the treatment, which is a really important thing that we're trying to look at as well. And ultimately, all left untouched, we have this increase in cancer-related and all-cause mortality. So what's been done? Funny enough, the context to all of this is that the field of exercise oncology is, in a relative sense, brand new. So the first study was like 1986, and it was kind of more safety feasibility. We don't know what's going on with cancer treatments. We don't know what these people can handle. So is it safe for them to exercise? Is there any adverse effects with exercise? And then throughout the 90s, it was more focused on reducing sedentary behavior, increasing overall physical activity levels. And now more recently, we're starting to see the need for targeted approaches from a trainer perspective to really target specific interventions. And so the bulk of the work in resistance training really has only come in the last 10 to 15 years. And I've selected this meta-analysis from Chen et al. Because while it focuses on prostate cancer, it does a really good job of profiling kind of what we have seen in the exercise oncology literature at large. So if we take resistance training interventions, you've got the top graph here is upper body strength, chest press, 1RM, and the lower body graph here is leg press, 1RM. In general, folks who take part in resistance training will see a meaningful improvement in upper and lower body strength, and particularly when you compare that to folks who don't participate or a control group. So you kind of see that reflected in the outcomes here. What's less conclusive and much more interesting to me is the changes in mass. So this, again, Chen reviewed all the resistance training interventions in prostate cancer, which they're not many. This is literally all it is in as long as we've known about the consequences of ADT. And look at the experimental control alone. So these are folks who've done resistance training, anywhere from 12 weeks up to a year of resistance training. And you're looking at a cap of about 0.7 kilograms. So for me to go through 12, 16, 34, up to 52 weeks of training to maybe get 0.7 kilograms of increase in lean mass, it's not something I'm you know, writing home about, particularly when you look at kind of the standard deviations, meaning that there's a lot of variability in how much people are able to respond. And then I'll also highlight Kerry Winterstone, another fantastic scientist, a year of training with no changes. And so this is in prostate cancer. We just finished up a meta-analysis that's in review at the minute where we wanted to expand this and look at kind of all the resistance training interventions in any cancer during or after treatment. And we're kind of seeing similar trends. So again, these are folks who take part in resistance training. You've got anywhere from a loss of 1.3-ish kilograms on treatment to maybe gain the kilogram to gain about half a kilogram. And then this is under the burden of treatment. So it's important to maintain that context. And then you look at survivorship. So this is the assumption that we've gotten past treatment, we've gotten past the burden of treatment. Theoretically, you should be good to go. You look better, you've regained your hair. Why can't you respond to training? And you look throughout this line. And again, this is resistance training after treatment. You've got people who have lost weight, lost lean mass in 26 to 52 weeks of resistance training. And so to me, this screams that there's something going on at the molecular level or whatever it is that's blunting the response to training. And it's particularly damning when you compare it to this Peterson review in MSSE is kind of a famous review in resistance training healthy older adults. You're looking at 1.1 kilograms in response to resistance training. That's in apparently healthy older adults. Now, if we remove the burden of treatment, we're only looking at an average of about 0.4 kilograms. So there's something going on there that in similar interventions, we're not able to see the same changes or magnitude of increase in mass. I will pause here because to provide context to all this, the results of our review was actually favorable towards resistance training when you put them in the context of people who don't resistance train. So a lot of the benefits that we saw in our review and in the literature at large is primarily due to preservation or reducing the rate of loss. So again, if you look at Jesper Christensen, this was in germ cell cancer. Jesper is a fantastic person and scientist, does some really rigorous resistance training protocols. Lost 1.3 kilogram with resistance training on treatment, but the control group lost 2.56. Similar kind of patterns where we look at, say, Katie Schmitz lost 1.2 with resistance training, lost 0.7 with control, where we're seeing some similar trends. There's a lot of variability in here going on where it's down to logistics, it's down to physiology, it's down to trial design. We can't conclusively say resistance training increases lean mass in cancer. There's a lot of work here to be done. Some of that is moving away from resistance training alone. So a lot of us in the area of oncology are kind of in these silos on our own, where folks in nutrition are trying to increase protein intake or dietary strategies. Physical therapy are trying to restore function. Some behavioral folks are trying to increase overall activity. And if we were to arbitrarily define this kind of optimal reversal of muscle loss, whatever we call it, I've already reviewed how many different factors are at large or at play that facilitate or lead to muscle loss. So it makes little sense to be targeting muscle loss specifically with a unimodal intervention. So instead of these interventions on their own, maybe there's a way where we can start to combine these. Can we adequately screen for people who are at risk of low muscle mass and intervene early? Can we combine that with resistance training? Maybe we chuck in some dietary modification there, particularly with a high protein diet focused on leucine content. Maybe chuck in some behavioral support where we use behavior change strategies to facilitate the adherence to the training and nutrition intervention. Maybe we chuck in some supplementation and borrow from the sports science world or older adults or the clinical population and see what we can do. We're at this stage now in the field of exercise oncology where a lot of us are less concerned about specifically what does X do to Y, and more, if we're trying to change Y, what does it take? And should we just throw the kitchen sink at it? Should we just throw everything at it and see what it will take to lead to meaningful changes? And if it happens, then we can kind of reverse engineer and start to look at individual factors. But I think this multimodal strategy is certainly the way a lot of us are thinking and a lot of us are developing our interventions around as well. Give you an idea of what we're doing. I was laughing. I saw Dustin's presentation this morning. It was absolutely phenomenal. Our intervention work is painstakingly slow at times. And so we started this trial in 2017, conceptualized in 2017, started in 2018. Probably won't get finished till 2022 with everything going on. But we're looking at 56 men with prostate cancer who are getting ADT. So again, ADT castrates testosterone, ton of physiological impairments, particularly low muscle mass. We're going to run them through a battery of tests, anything for quality of life and physical function through to strength of body comp, take some blood draws as well. And we've randomized them into an exercise or resistance exercise and creatine supplementation group to resistance exercise and placebo alone, to see if the addition of creatine supplementation can facilitate any additional benefits than resistance training alone. A couple of notes on this trial design. If you were to think of an absolute purist from a research perspective, you would really want the control group, folks who aren't doing anything here, so you kind of get a sense of what exercise is doing. We've had a lot of challenges with recruitment in exercise ecology because you're dealing with folks who tend to be going through a pretty vulnerable time, and you spend your recruitment efforts selling them on the benefits of exercise. And then you randomize them into exercise or control. And when you randomize them into control, you're like, yeah, sorry, dude, you know, you're not getting any exercise, see it in 12 to 16 weeks. And it's pretty tough to do that. A lot of us have started to move away from like the purest having a control group and more starting to look at these different types of interventions, where to me, if we see some benefit from creatine supplementation, great, good for them. If we don't, it gives us a lot more questions of why we didn't. And certainly the benefit to all the folks who participate, who are dedicating their time to this, everyone gets something. So it's my way of rationalizing to myself of having a more, I suppose, real world approach to where interventions are more, I suppose, effectiveness rather than efficacy. with that trial in general, that's kind of where we're at. We're looking at combining training with something else to see if we can have additive effects and see if we can have any sort of additional benefit on muscle mass and function. So the summary from that perspective kind of is, we've given you an overview that the cancer treatments result in accelerated decline in the musculoskeletal system. We've kind of progressed away from safety and are now moving into effectiveness for resistance training using specific targeted interventions. Certainly with the multimodal factors that are at play in contributing to muscle loss, I think there's a need for a multimodal approach to try and intervene on this. And some really interesting areas of development, I'm working with people a lot smarter than me on this. I think there's a really strong need to look at specifically what's going on at the molecular level. So can we get some biopsies? Can we get some muscle tissue itself and see what is the treatment doing to the muscle in humans? Because a lot of the signaling work has been done in preclinical models. But if we were to compare people going through chemotherapy compared to age-matched healthy controls who aren't receiving chemotherapy, and look at kind of some of these signaling mechanisms, it might give us a better understanding of not only the type of intervention we might select, but how these factors are affecting their ability to respond to interventions. So I think that's a really exciting area of future research that a lot of us are trying to move into. So we'll switch gears here and move into bone. And I wanted to provide context in the sense of cancer because, the general understanding is that we lose bone with age, and it's accelerated with cancer treatment. But a lot of people may not be as familiar with this idea of bone metastases. So jump in the quiz question there. We'll talk about what bone metastases means. Is it cancer that originates in the bone? Is it cancer that spreads to the bone? Or is it a result of trauma to the bone from cancer treatments?
Okay, I see the answers coming in. We'll give everyone a few more seconds to respond.
Nice. Man, y'all are a lot smarter than I was when I was taking this these general classes. So bone metastases is a result of advanced cancer. It's cancer that spreads to the bone. There's a really important context to this in relation to what we do. So if you think about how bone health is maintained, it operates very similar to protein metabolism, where you've got bone that is being degraded, old, nasty kind of bone that needs to be remodeled. And then you've got new bone being built. And this rate of kind of breaking down and building up bone occurs in a similar way to protein synthesis, but at a much slower rate. It occurs in you're talking months and years. But in the context of cancer, understanding the difference between osteoblast activity, where osteoblasts facilitate bone formation, osteoclast activity, they resorb bone. So they're the ones they kind of cleave or resorb the bone or break it down to be built back up. How and when cancer spreads to the bone could be different based on the type of cancer and result in different lesions. So basically you'll have some sort of lesion here, cancer cells spread to the bone and start to break off and grow, metastasize. Common sites, ribs, spine, throughout the body. But what happens is in osteolytic lesions, which is common in breast cancer and multiple myeloma, we have an increase in osteoclast activity. This is really important because we also have a decrease in osteoblast activity. So at a very specific site of metastases, we have this high rate of bone degradation and we're not recovering it. So the risk of fracture in advanced cancer with breast or multiple myeloma or other cancers with these osteolytic lesions is quite high. So we have to be very careful about how we load the bone. And there has been a lot of fear about what these folks can tolerate. Compare and contrast that to osteoblastic lesions, which is lesions that land and kind of facilitate osteoblastic growth. So a lot more bone formation, again, a specific site of metastases, fairly common in prostate cancer, where the risk of fracture isn't necessarily as high, But certainly there's a lot of pain with having bone formation throughout your body. So what does this look like? You could have one or two spots and they might be fairly manageable, where if you have a spot in your spine, your pelvis, you may be able to accommodate that with some configurations to your exercise sessions. But it could also look like this. And this is not uncommon in advanced cancers. And so if you think about this as someone with breast cancer, we need to be very careful about how we're loading these folks. And so Drs. Daniel Gaveau and the crew over there in Australia, where I did my postdoc, led the way in developing this multimodal modified program for bone metastases. So what you're seeing is a protocol they developed where they looked at the site of metastases and essentially gave indicators of whether it was okay to target the region, whether we need to exclude specific movements as it relates to where the metastases is located, or exclude that site of metastases in general, with the whole idea of you're trying to limit the shear stress on the bone and reduce the risk of fractures. But this is what it could look like. If you've got metastases spread throughout the body, you know, you could have someone coming into your clinic, and if you're using that M3EP program that they developed, you're really limited to maybe a few wrist curls. You might do some isometric exercises, maybe unload them and stick them on a recumbent bike to get some sort of cardiovascular exercise. And I'm providing you this slide in the context of the results of their intervention, where they looked at this relative to folks who didn't exercise. So you're looking at changes from baseline to 3 months in folks who exercised versus folks who didn't. And really, you know, there's some findings we saw had self-reported physical function. So they felt like they had better physical function. Leg extension improved in those who participate in the exercise group. Important caveat: of the 50 something that were in the trial, only nine in the exercise group and 12 in the control group were actually able to do the leg extension because they were contraindicated. So again, when we talk about feasibility, it's feasible in people who can actually do the protocol, but there's a lot of people who are contraindicated to actually do exercise in general. So other than that, you're kind of seeing, you know, not much is different, primarily due to how modified the program was. So there's definitely conversations around the value of how much we should we do and how much is enough to improve psychosocial function versus physical function. Another really interesting trial, which gives you an idea where this field is going, Rosenberger et al. This year published a trial in unstable spinal metastases. So kind of like the most intense population, I suppose, really high fracture risk. And they looked at isometric spinal stabilization for 10 days. While this looks simple to you and I, this is intense for people with extensive bone metastases and how careful you have to be about modifying the exercise and moving them up and down out of the ground and things like that. So the fact that they were able to pull this off, I think, is really a testament to the work that they're doing. But again, it was more kind of a feasibility trial where we're just looking at, can they do it? Saw some meaningful changes in muscular endurance that they kind of related to plank holding time. But again, a lot of deviations from pain, immobility, weakness. So a lot of the work now is starting to see or look at different programs for different people. What is feasible for who, and how can we modify the program enough to accommodate metastases, but also get some sort of benefit out of it? So a lot of, when I say resistance exercise is safe and well tolerated for bone metastases, a lot of caveats to that. The resistance exercise has been extensively modified. It's not the resistance exercise that you and I would think of. And well tolerated for the people who are well enough to actually be enrolled in the study to tolerate. So there's a lot of people that are contraindicated to it. Our current evidence is primarily limited largely breast and prostate cancer. So we don't say multiple myeloma is a completely different beast in terms of the metastases that's involved there. So we don't know much outside these populations. And certainly future research is looking to a more strategically loading sites of metastases. So far we've been really careful about avoiding loading any site of metastases. So the Rosenberger trial was kind of one of the first to use body weight to load isometrically. And now we're trying to see how much we can do and what's the limit there as well. So some really interesting research going on in that area. And I'll finish off with symptoms. And I think this is a really interesting area and application for resistance training. This whole project came as a conversation with my good friend, Carolyn McIntyre, who's doing some fantastic work in lung cancer over in Australia. I was fairly ignorant to lung cancer, but dyspnea, or shortness of breath, is a real big limiting factor of a lot of their activities. So typically the concept looks like this. We've got shortness of breath to high intensity or high loads of activity. So we'll avoid that activity. Go, no, don't want to deal with it. Don't want to deal with the discomfort. Don't want to deal with air hunger or grasping for breath. So if you avoid activity, deconditioning occurs. And what happens with deconditioning is that dyspnea starts to occur at lower intensities. So we start to avoid lower intensities, avoid them even further, more deconditioning, and then dyspnea starts to become a problem with ADLs too. So we have this kind of spiral of decline that, again, the fear of exacerbating dyspnea, the fear of going into discomfort with it, contributes to avoidance of activity, contributes to deconditioning, and results in this accelerated progression towards mortality. So importantly, dyspnea is not out on an island on its own. A lot of folks with lung cancer are experience a lot of different symptoms, and the dyspnea can be impacted by fatigue and sleep disruption. What a lot of my conversations with Carolyn were coming down to was listening to what she was going through in some of her interventions and some of her colleagues. When you think about a traditional repetition scheme of 1 to 3 sets of 10 or whatever, because the dyspnea is such a rate limiting factor, what people will do, they'll reduce the load of training so much to allow the person to get 10 repetitions. So dyspnea is the rate limiting factor, not muscular fatigue. I'm out of breath, I can't do 10. So we'll reduce the load to a point where you can do 10 with a given load. The problem is, if you're reducing the load so much to accommodate dyspnea or shortness of breath, you're not actually loading the system sufficiently to warrant any adaptation. So cluster sets are kind of a really niche a topic that stemmed from kind of sports science. Greg Hoff led a lot of this work in looking at if you intersperse this traditional rep range with little mini breaks of rest, can you dissipate fatigue and maintain the quality of the repetitions? A lot of interesting work in Olympic lifting and things like that. But we propose the same idea here, where instead of your traditional set of 10, why don't we give folks a couple of repetitions, give them 15, 20 seconds, let you catch your breath, reset, get back to where you're at, do another two repetitions, another 20 second break, and continue that pattern on. And it's a lot of ifs, but if the rest allows us to alleviate some symptoms of dyspnea, it may be allowed them to tolerate a greater load, which may lead to greater adaptations down the line. So we're really interested and excited about testing this out in a sample of non-small cell lung cancer. We're looking at a feasibility trial. We're piloting the configuration with a few folks now and looking to get our feasibility trial off the ground this summer. But again, just taking folks, about 15 people with non-small cell lung cancer, running them through a battery of tests of physical function, strength, dyspnea, taking them through our six-week intervention as it relates to cluster sets, and then testing them again and seeing how this changes anything and how to respond to it, and certainly the feasibility of all of it put together. I certainly recognize that I come home to my partner raving like a lunatic about some of these ideas, and I'm like, this could be amazing. As it stands right now, I think I've given you a fairly compelling rationale for why we should look at this, but we haven't looked at it yet, and there's no evidence for it. So what we have now is potential for, it's certainly not evidence of, the ability of cluster sets to target dyspnea, but it's an exciting project that we're working on. Hopefully we'll be able to give you some results in the near future. So with that, I'll kind of give...
Sorry to interrupt, it's just 5 minutes.
No, you're good. We're on the money. So yeah, the overall summary is that there's a variability in the incidence and severity of muscle and bone loss in cancer. Again, I do think the multimodal intervention, there's going to be a lot of challenges and limitations in designing RCTs or randomized control trials to do this, but they're likely going to be the best bet at yielding success in this area. And I think resistance training has been by far underutilized and certainly has a lot of potential to be examined across the cancer continuum, both treatment-related impairments and various cancer-related symptoms as well. So with that, again, I thank the UCF crew. You've been doing a fantastic job, and look forward to any questions.
Thank you so much, Dr. Fairman. That was wonderful. We have a handful of questions here for you. First one being, are there any research implications that suggest that the anabolic hormonal cascade that is inherent as an adaptation to acute chronic strength training can increase tumor growth as well?
Great question. I don't want to give you an uninformed answer. I'm assuming we would have seen it already. If in the context of prostate cancer, testosterone is the thing that drives prostate cancer growth. So there's no real risk of raising basal levels of testosterone with folks who are on ADT because their treatment is cutting off testosterone. So you might have maybe mini acute fluctuations, but we're not seeing it at the rate that would kind of increase the risk of recurrence in those patient populations. And then as far as like other populations where it's not really a factor, I wouldn't think so, but I'll hedge my bets.
All right, thank you for that. Another one here. Do we think that the low pressures of blood flow restriction with low loads would be something to explore with this population?
Massively. I really like that idea. I certainly welcome people trying it out. I tried blood flow restriction and I personally hated it. So that's my bias against it. But I think there's certainly a lot of applications in the survivorship population, people who don't have access to the same type of equipment that we would in the lab. I'm running the risk of going over time here, but one interesting application of this, a lot of folks are looking at tumor blood flow in the tumor itself and seeing if how we modulate tumor blood flow based on exercise training can increase flow to the tumor and increase the delivery of treatment. I wonder if there's an application for BFR there. But Paolo Rivera, I'd love to chat to you more about kind of kick some ideas around.
All right. Thank you so much. That was wonderful. Very informative. For all of our attendees, Dr. Fairman will be around at our 4 p.m. social hour if you have more questions for him. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Just give us a couple seconds as we transition to our next speaker.